We are studying about research methodologies. There are many research methods which fall under two categories. Some methods are quantitative research methods, whereas some methods are qualitative research methods. Let us understand what we mean by qualitative research. Let us start with an example. We have learnt about a doctor and his team who are working in a tribal area. Doctor with his team are engaged in training of some health workers there. They are engaged in spreading awareness with goals of decreasing infant mortality, improving health of pregnant women, and improving health of infants. This intervention is a long-term intervention. Several years they are working in this area, and so far they have conducted many training programs for health workers. Now we want to learn impact of his and his team's intervention in that area. You might have learnt about some quantitative methods. What do you think? If you want to study impact of this doctor's intervention, what method can we use? Think about it. Can we use survey? You might be thinking that we can give questionnaire to some health workers and to some families and collect data. Or you might also be thinking that we can use pre-test before training, post-test after training, and find out difference between the scores. If we think carefully, are we really going to learn each and every aspect of their intervention, their efforts which are put over the period of time, their interactions with the families, their interactions with the health workers, merely by questionnaires, merely by pre-test and post-test, or want to go into more details to find out about the real interactions, quality of the whole intervention? If we really decide to find out more details, observe each and every aspect, talk to health workers, interview health workers, talk to different families, then we may need to take many other notes. We may need to keep observations. We may need to spend more time with these families and in this tribal area. Here, we are talking about qualitative research. If you find this interesting, let us understand how qualitative research is different than quantitative research. What are specific characteristics of qualitative research? To understand basic components of qualitative research, Maxwell has given a model. Let us see what is there in Maxwell model. Maxwell in 1998 proposed a model consisting of five components which are there useful for conducting qualitative research. The first component is goals of the study. Let us see what we mean by this. Goals are the statements of purpose of the study or the question that will be hopefully answered, just as in logico-positivist research questions. We first ask ourselves, what do we want to study? What do we want to find out? And accordingly, we define our goals. On the basis of these goals, we decide the next steps. Through these goals, we are trying to find out some logico-positivist answers. The second component is context of the study. What is the context in which study is being contemplated? What is the background or literature that addresses the research problem. In second component, we try to find out context of the entire research. Now here, if you consider example of the tribal area and doctor's intervention there, you will realize that context is very important in qualitative research. What is the background in which the whole intervention is going on? Which culture are we going to study? Which phenomena are we going to analyze? And in which context? So context is another important component of qualitative research. What does the researcher want to study as conclusion of the study? What is not known, and how will the research inform that understanding? Researcher conducts qualitative analysis because he or she wants to find out some conclusions. What are these findings? What is that which is understood at the end of the study? This conclusion is important in qualitative research. Now, goals are decided. We want some conclusions. And for that, in a particular context, we want to proceed ahead with the study. For this, we need to design some techniques. We need to decide what strategies will we apply. These research strategies, approaches, techniques are important component of qualitative research. Who is being studied and how these individuals are selected, that is also important factor in qualitative research. Any research has three parts: design of the research, data collection, and analysis. So when we discuss characteristics of qualitative research, we need to discuss qualitative research in terms of its design strategies, in terms of data collection. In qualitative research, fieldwork is also important for data collection. And the third aspect is analysis. So we need to study characteristics of qualitative research in terms of analysis strategies. Let us start with design strategies. We discuss about naturalistic inquiry, emergent design, and purposeful sampling. What is naturalistic inquiry? Again, if you go back to our example of doctor's intervention, we realize that it's a real world situation. In qualitative research, we analyze, we study real world situations, phenomena, real people working in the field. In naturalistic inquiry, we study real world situations, natural phenomena, real people and their work, or maybe a culture. These real world situations are to be studied and analyzed. So it's not a fixed design which we will apply. Our entire inquiry will be natural. It will be based on observations. It will be non-manipulative and non-controlling. If you have studied experimental design, you might have studied there that control and manipulation are key characteristics of experimental method, which is not the case here. You cannot manipulate qualitative research. You cannot control variables of qualitative research. On the contrary, you are interested in analyzing, studying real variables. For example, you will not specifically design a training program to implement as we do in experiment, but you will study impact of ongoing training program naturally happening in the field and study all its aspects. By naturalistic inquiry, we also mean openness to whatever emerges. This openness is very important for a researcher. The researcher cannot be biased or should not get disturbed by whatever emerges naturally, whatever changes occur in the field. On the contrary, researchers should analyze and study impact of those changes. So, lack of predetermined constraints on findings is an important characteristic of qualitative research. We cannot say that everything should be predetermined. No, that is not called as qualitative research. So, what is an emergent design? Emergent design is the design which evolves after we start the study, after we plan everything, because of some changes, because of some occurrences, events in the natural scenario, our field where we are going to conduct our naturalistic inquiry, our qualitative research. For understanding which deepens as the situations change, we need openness to adaptive inquiry. We need to avoid getting locked into rigid designs which eliminate responsiveness. We are open to pursuing new paths of discovery as they emerge. So when we adapt inquiry, so to understand emergent design, we need to be open to adapting inquiry. We should not be getting bound by rigid designs which restrict responsiveness. And we also need to pursue new paths of discovery. New designs may also emerge through this study. Sample is purposeful in qualitative research. You might have learnt about sampling and sampling techniques, and you also might have learnt that for true experimental research, we need random sampling. We need to be very systematic, scientifically disciplined while selecting sample. Now, if you want to get engaged in naturalistic inquiry, you cannot manipulate your sample. You cannot select your sample randomly or systematically. We need to work and study existing people, available people who are open to response. Observations, detailed information, and open responses are very important in qualitative research, and that's why people, events, phenomena are deliberately, purposefully selected. You inquire such an event which makes a difference. You would like to analyze, study a person who is making a difference, and that's why your sample is purposive. Your sample is selected because they are information rich and illuminative. You are getting some qualitative data, and that's why you have selected that particular sample. You offer useful manifestations of the phenomena. You select a sample which offers useful manifestations of the phenomenon, and your cases which you study are not for empirical generalizations. The moment we say that we want to generalize conclusions, findings, we are more concerned about selection of sample because we want to generalize our results. Here our aim is not to generalize our results but to study that particular phenomenon in detail, and that's why our sample is not for generalizing our results from a sample to population. Now let us discuss what are characteristics of qualitative research in terms of data collection strategies and fieldwork strategies. Data is qualitative. Data comes from personal experience and engagement. Our data collection happens through empathetic neutrality and mindfulness, and our data collection strategies are dynamic systems. Let us see nature of the data. Data is qualitative. It's not only scores that matter to us. That's not only quantity, not quantitative data. Qualitative data is based on observation which yield detailed and thick description. We are interested in very minute detailed observations of a culture, maybe an intervention, maybe of a case, of a person, of a phenomenon. Interviews capture direct quotations about people's personal perspectives. Because we want qualitative data, we are more interested in understanding people's perceptions about that particular event, and that's why we use interview technique. Detailed interviews help here and not the structured ones. As much as data, as much as perspectives you gather from people makes your research rich. Your inquiry should be in depth. We use case study approaches because detailed case is studied, and careful document reviews are very important. Whatever documents are available, try to analyze, we try to review those documents to find more and more information for us, which is helpful in our data analysis. When you talk about detailed observation, case studies, interviewing people in detail, you can understand that staying with those people, spending more and more time in that particular context with those people is very important. You need to have personal touch to the whole context. You need to spend time with those people to understand them fully or in detail. Here, researcher has direct contact with these people, and researcher gets close to people, situation, and also phenomenon which is under study. Researcher's personal experiences of this phenomena, of this event, about these people are very important. So, with these personal experiences, researcher gets involved, researcher becomes important part of the inquiry, and researcher is very critical about understanding this phenomenon. If we talk about data collection and fieldwork strategies, we need to talk about an important aspect. This characteristic is very interesting: empathetic neutrality and mindfulness. Now, if you try to understand the term empathetic, you will ask, how come one be empathetic at the same time and neutral at the same time? But yes, for qualitative research, empathetic neutrality is very important, and along with that, there should be complete mindfulness. Let us understand how it is possible. In empathetic neutrality and mindfulness, an empathetic science in interviewing seeks understanding without judgment by showing openness, respect, sensitivity, awareness, and responsiveness in observation. What we mean by that? We need to be empathetic about the whole situation. We need to be open and sensitive about this situation. If we are not sensitive, if we don't have respect about that particular context or situation, we will not be able to gather qualitative data. If you have faith, some respect in that intervention which doctor is doing in tribal area, then only researcher will be open to collect as much as information he or she seeks. You are interviewing people, so you need to be empathetic with those people. You need to be sensitive about the intervention. But whenever you are sensitive, whenever you are empathetic, you also need to be very unbiased. You need to be mindful but neutral. You may not get biased and involved in the situation. Unbiased involvement is very important in qualitative research, which is actually a challenge. Systems are dynamic. Systems are real-world situations which you are analyzing and studying, and that's why adapting various changes is very necessary in qualitative research. We need to have attention to process. Dynamic systems assume change on ongoing, whether focus is on an individual, an organization, a community, or an entire culture. While doing this research, we need to assume that there is bound to some change, because you are not controlling or manipulating anything. You are studying the entire system, which is dynamic in nature. May it be a person, may it be a situation, may it be an event, a phenomena. You are studying it, and simultaneously it is changing. It may change. There may be some unexpected events happening, but we need to be open for that, ready to accept these changes, and we need to assume this change. Our mindfulness and attention to such situations, to such systems, is very necessary. Let us now discuss characteristics of qualitative research in terms of its analysis strategies. What do we do when we analyze qualitative research? We use unique case orientation. We also use inductive analysis and creative synthesis. We hold holistic perspective of analysis. We are context sensitive, and researcher's voice, perspective, and reflexivity matters in this analysis. Let us see these characteristics one by one. What is unique case orientation? As you have learnt in other quantitative methods, we try to generalize our findings. But while discussing qualitative analysis, we discussed that each case is important, that case study is important, and we don't aim to generalize these results. That's why every case needs to be analyzed for its special characteristics, for its special features, and we analyze, study a particular case as an unique case. We study it because this is special, this is different for us. We assume that each case is special and unique. The first level of analysis is being true to respecting and capturing the details of the individual cases being studied. Even cross-case analysis follows afterwards from the unique case, and it depends on the quality of individual case studies. Comparison of two different groups, comparison of two different treatments is not an aim here. First, we analyze one system, we may analyze another system, and then there can be cross-case study if we think that these two cases are worthy comparing. Inductive analysis and creative synthesis is another characteristic. What do we mean by inductive analysis? Immersion in the details and specifics of the data to discover important patterns, themes, and interrelationships. It begins by exploring and then confirming, guided by analytical principles rather than rules. It ends with a creative synthesis. In inductive analysis, we try to emerge into details. We try to find out detailed characteristics, detailed aspects of this particular context. As we are discussing, it may be an intervention in a particular context, in a particular culture, or it may be about some persons who are demonstrating special characteristics. So, inductive analysis is about finding out something which is unique. We try to discover from these detailed observations some patterns, some themes which we can demonstrate and present for the world. With these patterns, one can understand this scenario, one can understand and study this case. Then, for these interrelationships, for these themes and patterns, we try to explore and confirm something which is emerged out of creative synthesis. Here we are not guided by strict rules, rather we depend on analytical principles. We try to explore and emerge some different principles and themes which help us in synthesizing the whole situation synthetically. We try to establish some interrelationships from whatever observations we have gathered. We need to have holistic perspective of the whole situation in contrast to control, because in control we try to control all variables and try to study our interdependent and dependent variable in research. But because this is not an experimental research, we don't believe in controlling variables. On the contrary, instead of focusing only on one or two variables, we try to have an holistic perspective, study and analyze all possible variables, all possible aspects of it. And in this holistic context, we try to understand the phenomenon. The whole phenomena under study is understood as a complex system that is more than the sum of its parts. It focuses on complex interdependencies and system dynamics that cannot meaningfully be reduced to a few discrete variables and linear or causal-effect relationships. For example, if we plan to study doctor's team's intervention in a tribal area, can we focus only on one training program? No, we cannot. We need to understand family background, cultures, rituals of that tribal area. We need to understand why infant mortality was high. What are the variables which are causing this? And what is doctor's team exactly doing? What all are they changing? How are they interacting with the families? Now, have these families started thinking in different manner? If yes, how? In what manner were they thinking before and how are they thinking now? What are different aspects of their interventions? How health workers' training programs are happening? How are health workers interacting with the families? So you can understand this is a very complex situation. There are many, many variables which are acting in this situation. So holistic perspective is very important in analyzing the facts. Context sensitivity is another characteristic of qualitative research. What do we mean by being sensitive about the whole context? We have already seen that we need to consider our case as a unique case. We have also seen that our aim is not to generalize the results, but instead we need to be sensitive about this particular context, this particular scenario, this particular culture, these people whom we are trying to analyze and study. For that, context sensitivity is important. By context sensitivity, we mean that it places findings in a social, historical, and temporal context, careful about, even dubious of, the possibility or meaningfulness of generalizations across time and space. Rather, it emphasizes instead careful comparative case analysis and extrapolating patterns for possible transferability and adaptation in new settings. So rather, we are doubtful whether whatever findings we will get will be worth generalizing. We are not interested in that. We first try to understand the case, then get engaged in cross-case analysis, then we try to find out, explore some new patterns which will interpret the situation in better manner, and then we can think of implementing the same patterns somewhere else. For example, after studying doctor's intervention in this tribal area, if our documents are very detailed with proper synthesis, there are chances that others will study these documents, study our research findings, and then we will try to implement, somebody somewhere will try to implement this model in another area. That can be the motive. But mere quantitative interpretation and generalization is not at all an objective of qualitative analysis. In qualitative analysis, researchers' voice, researchers' own perspectives, researchers' own reflections are very important. Researcher cannot be very objective, and researcher cannot be totally subjective or biased also. But then, researcher needs to be very balanced. His or her own voice, reflections, interpretations, insights about the whole situation are very important. These are considered as authentic observations and authentic reflections. Researcher's voice is considered as trustworthy in qualitative analysis. On the contrary, in quantitative analysis, researcher has no role. Whatever are the scores, whatever is the statistical analysis, and whatever are the findings are only the speaking data. Conclusions are derived only from scores, which is not the case in qualitative analysis. When you write your synthesis, your interpretations, those are considered as very valuable findings. So, voice, perspective, and reflexivity of researcher matters a lot. To sum up, the quantitative analysis is more based on scoring, whereas qualitative analyst owns and it is reflective about his or her own voice and perspective. A credible voice which conveys authenticity and trustworthiness. Complete objectivity is impossible, and pure subjectivity undermines credibility. The researcher's focus here becomes balance, understanding and depicting the world authentically in all its complexity while being self-analytical, politically aware, and reflexive in conscience. We have studied various characteristics of qualitative research here. Now, I am sure you might be interested in understanding various methods that fall under qualitative research, and I am sure you must be geared up to undertake at least one qualitative analysis study.